Hello everyone, and welcome to a very special video. It is the Whispers of the Old Gods as seen through the lens of One Night in Karazhan. So basically what I wanted to do is I had seen a lot of really neat interactions that were coming out of One Night in Karazhan. A lot of new decks, a lot of new archetypes, a lot of new interactions, and I also watched a video where a streamer re-reviewed their previous review video. And what that allowed them to do is to see how good they were at analyzing cards. It allowed them to see, you know, were they able to predict future interactions? Were they able to see how cards played together? You know, were there interactions that they just flat out missed? Did they how did they analyze cards and how did they think about the cards and their interactions and how they came together? So that's what I wanted to do today. So I never really got a chance to actually make a Whispers of the Old Gods review video because I hadn't actually started streaming at that point. So this is going to be also, in a sense, a makeup video for my review of Whispers of the Old Gods. So let's get started. Let's take a look at what we got over here. Boom. Coming up first, Forbidden Ritual. So one of the great interactions about Forbidden Ritual is obviously the Darkshire Councilman. Play Darkshire Councilman on 3, it doesn't die. Forbidden Ritual on 4, now you got a 5/5, or you know, less if it got attacked into. really good interaction, really neat card. It's actually seen less play than I had originally thought. I thought this was going to be a double auto include in every single zoo deck, and it ended up becoming one where they kind of only had one, just because there's so many other cards now that clear 1/1s. this is actually the effect of Maelstrom Portal in One Night in Karazhan, is it ended up making Forbidden Ritual weaker than it originally was. Originally, it was Ravaging Ghoul and, to a lesser extent, Eternal Flame Caller that were kind of keeping them back. And now Maelstrom Portal is also making this one of those cards that just isn't really seeing as much play as I had originally thought. And it turns out that just being able to make a bunch of 1/1s, you know, it's just not that effective anymore. So when this card first came out, I was very high on it. I would have given it an 8. Now, unfortunately, it's like a 5 or a 6. It's not really seeing a whole lot of play anymore. Number 2, Forbidden Shaping. Spend all your mana, summon a random minion that costs that much. Another one of those cards that I was actually very high on when it first came out. I thought, finally, this is the card that Priest needs. That Priest is finally going to have that 2-drop, 3-drop, 4-drop, you know, when they need it on demand. You can hold it for the late game and summon an 8-drop. But it turns out that most of the minions that you get from this card, they require a battle cry to actually be effective. And so when you get them without the battle cry, they end up kind of sucking. And it just became one of the early casualties of most Priest decks. One of the big Priest decks that came out of One Night in Karazhan is the Resurrect Priest. And this is terrible with the Resurrect Priest, because you'd be making a card and then resurrecting it, and who knows if that card's any good or not. And then you double up on a bad effect, or a no battle cry effect. Nobody needs that. And while it does see the occasional play in fringe Priest decks, Priest itself is already a fringe class, and Resurrect Priest is neat, and it's a pretty good deck, but it's by no means a tier 1 deck, and it does have a tendency to just get run over by aggro shaman and a lot of the other aggro, you know, aggro hunter and stuff like that. So it ended up not being a very good card. So originally I would have given this, you know, expectations would have been a 10, and in reality it's like a 2 or a 3. So this is just one of those, you know, a prime example of how our expectations going into something change once you actually get to play with the cards. Next one is Vile Fin Inquisitor. 1 mana, 1/3, battle cry, your hero power becomes summon a 1/1 Murloc. Now, initially, people thought this was going to combine with Anything Can Happen, and it would make sure that you got a bunch of Murloc's back for your anything can happen. But now people are like, why would I want that? I actually don't want that. I really only want specific Murlocs to come back, i.e. the Bluegill Warrior and the Murloc the Murloc Raid Leader. That's all you want. You want to buff your Murlocs and you want to charge the Murlocs. So getting any 1-1 Murlocs coming back actually decreases the power of anything can happen. And so this card actually got cut quickly. Now the weird part is, it's a 1-mana 1/3, so that's pretty strong, you know, which is nice for the early game. The problem is 1/3s are pretty weak even on turn 1, because most things that you're going to play against have 2 health. 1/3s are really only effective against 2/1s, and honestly, people aren't really playing 2/1s anymore. The only time they're seeing play would be like in a Hunter with like Fiery Bat, and occasionally the Buccaneer in a Pirate Rogue deck, but that, again, that's not even that. You just don't see that in the meta very often. And since it can't get buffed like a Tunnel Trog would, it ends up not seeing play. The crazy part is, though, in Karazhan, they introduced this idea of the menagerie of Murloc, Beast, and Dragon buff cards. And also the idea of the Curator summoning these creatures. And Vilefin Inquisitor is actually seeing some play in Zoo Paladin decks and Menagerie Paladin decks. And it ends up being really good because it provides you with a Murloc to buff that doesn't require you to put it in your deck aside from the Vilefin Inquisitor. So you only need to put this card in there and then you'll occasionally get a 2-2. Or a 3-2 if the Menagerie Magician comes out. So it ends up being a pretty effective card in that deck. The problem is that deck is typically not as good as the Dragon Paladin deck and some of the other Aggro Paladin. It's not, you know, it's about on par with Aggro Paladin, and Aggro Paladin isn't really seeing a lot of play. So unfortunately, this card, nor the other Zoo cards, were able to really elevate Paladin into contention in the upper tiers, but it's still a fun deck, it's still a good deck, and it's relatively effective. It just probably won't get you past level 5 at the max, I would say. So moving on, Zealous Initiate. Everybody thought this card sucked. Guess what? It still sucks. Death Rattle, give a random friendly minion +1/+1. So it's a Death Rattle, so it has to die, and you can't always control when it dies, and it gets easily pinged off. I don't know, maybe, you know, it's tried in a few Nazoth decks, and then people were like, I don't even want this card back. It's taken up spots that, you know, my Tyrion should get back, or my Sylvanas should fill. And so, ended up not seeing play, and this is one of those cards where I think we were all spot on, and we knew that this card would suck. Forbidden Flame. Here's another one of those cards. Actually, all the Forbidden cards are very similar, in a sense that they're very flexible. And everybody was just like, well, throw them in, right? Just put them in the deck, because they're so flexible, they could fit anywhere. Well, the problem with flexibility is it doesn't have a lot of power, and it doesn't have a lot of specific power. And so Forbidden Flame, since it can't go face, and it spend all your mana, and then deal that much damage to a minion. So a lot of times it just ended up being cut because people wanted more specific removal, or they wanted burn that could actually go face as well. And so Forbidden Flame ended up getting cut. You do see it occasionally in a Reno Mage deck, but again, Reno Mage is not really in the meta either. So high hopes for Forbidden Flame. It eventually burnt out. Huh, get it? Burnt out. All right, next up, Forbidden Healing. Spend all your mana, restore twice that much health. Forbidden Healing, I thought it was an excellent card, and I thought it was going to fit in every single deck. My problem with Forbidden Healing is you end up not doing anything with that turn. So unless it's like turn 10 or above and you're healing for 20, a lot of times you end up basically skipping the turn just to heal. And the problem with that is your opponent gets to play minions and gets to continue to get tempo and pressure on you. So it has seen play in N'Zoth Paladin. But N'Zoth Paladin has kind of fallen off the meta. And the reason is because it's kind of slow and it gets run over. And so its early game isn't really that good. And Forbidden Healing was sort of the card that initially was supposed to bridge that gap. You know, you play it on turn 6, you heal 12, you get another turn, maybe you can do something with it. It ended up not really being that effective and was basically a card to try to keep you alive while you were playing into fatigue. And it's just not really seeing a lot of play outside of that one deck, and that one deck honestly is not seeing a lot of play either. Unfortunately, it's been really difficult to find a good Paladin deck these days. I think I found one. If you want to watch my other video on the Egg Paladin, please do so and play that deck, because it is super fun and is a surprisingly effective deck. But Forbidden Healing's not in it. I don't know. Might find a spot, might not. But let's move on. Again, another one of those cards where we wanted it to be good. It just ended up not being good. Alright, here we go. Possessed Villager. 1 mana, 1/1, Death Rattle, summon a 1/1 Shadow Beast. It's a Warlock card. Initially, people thought this card was actually seemed weak. And the reason they thought it seemed weak is because it's a 1/1 that spawns a 1/1. Who gives a shit? I have an Argent Squire for that. Why don't I just use that? People were saying Argent Squire is more effective. Why would I put this in instead of Argent Squire? And when I first saw this card, I was like, no. This card is good. It survives AoE, and you can power overwhelming it, trade up, still have a 1-1 left. Also, the 1-1 that comes out of it gets summoned. So it works with Knife Juggler. It works with Darkshire Councilman. It's an effective card, you know, and it pretty much guarantees that you have board presence. It's like a mini Haunted Creeper. And in some ways, it's better than Argent Squire, and in some ways, it's worse than Argent Squire. What I would say about this card is, in Zoo, you want to have a lot of cheap, effective, efficient minions. And getting what is essentially amounts to a 2-2 for 1 mana, or a 1-2 for 1 mana, is really good. You know, being able to direct this damage at least twice is really effective, and like I said, it guarantees you a board presence. You know, they're gonna have to deal with it. So what ends up happening is people just put Argent Squire and Possessed Villager in the same Zoo deck, and it was that much better. You know, being able to tap play something means you need a lot of 1/1s, especially like on turn 3 or on turn 5 or something like that. So Possessed Villager filled that role quite nicely, and I think the people that were down on it were proven wrong. So here's one of those cards where our expectations were low, and it ended up far exceeding it, and so you still see it in Zoo decks to this day. Alrighty, moving on. Selfless Hero. 1 mana, 2/1, Death Rattle, give a random friendly minion Divine Shield. God dang it, like, I love this card. I think it's a good card. I like it. I want to put it in my Paladin decks. It's not the fault of the card that it ends up not seeing play. It's kind of the fault of Paladin in general. Paladin's place in this meta is, like, it's just not there. We're just not finding an effective deck. And so it's more the fault of an effective Paladin deck that can utilize Selfless Hero versus the fault of Selfless Hero. One of the problems is it only has one health. So it ends up getting pinged off very easily. This card would have been awesome if the stats were flipped and it was a 1-2. Because then you could play it, it couldn't get pinged off, you could play another creature, and then trade it in, and now the other thing gets Divine Shield. That's the idea of Selfless Hero. Also, the idea would be, like, play a couple of creatures and Selfless Hero, and then now your opponent is trying to figure out a way to kill everything else, and then kill your Selfless Hero last. And so it forces him to make ineffective trades. So no matter where this card comes out, unless you're on a top deck war, it's a good card. It's effective, you know, but it's just a matter of finding an effective Paladin deck that can actually utilize Selfless Hero. There was a Divine Shield aggro Paladin that was in vogue for a little while, but it had pretty much died out once One Night in Karazhan came around. And it's not like Karazhan was the one that blew it out of the water. It just meant that by that point, the deck was pretty much ineffective and you basically don't see it. So a card that I still love, I still have high hopes for, but like I said, in this particular meta, it's just not seeing play. Moving on, Shifter Zeris. 1 mana, 1/1. Each turn this in your hand, transform it into a random minion. This was another, it's a legendary, and people were up in arms about this card. They're like, oh my god, it's OP, I can't believe it. 1 mana, you get anything you want, man. Well, it turns out there's a crap ton of minions in this game, and the likelihood of you just getting crap is high. You don't even see this in a Reno lock deck. Like, there are literally Reno decks that are like, nope, no Shifter Zeris. And it's just too unreliable. You know, oftentimes it just sits in your hand the whole time. And how often do you find a time when this minion that is probably subpar is actually going to help you? I mean, yes, there are those fringe benefits where it comes out, but it's not really worth taking up a deck slot. You know, if your card can only help you 1% of the time and you only have 30 deck slots, you know, you need your cards to be more effective than that. So Shifter Zeris, everybody was right in it. We're all wrong in that sense that we thought it was going to be good and it just ended up being bad. Ended up not working. All right, moving on. Tentacle of N'Zoth. 1 mana, 1/1. Death Rattle. Deal 1 damage to all minions. So the thing you got to remember at the time, this card was actually rated quite highly. The reason is because we did not have a lot of whirlwind effects, at least effective whirlwind effects, once Deathbite was taken out of the standard rotation. So the thinking was, this would just be a 2-of in patron decks. And there you go. You know, then we'd have Whirlwind, we'd have Revenge, and then we'd also have Tentacle and N'Zoth. And then Ravaging Ghoul was also introduced. 4 Whirlwind effects, you could double them up, you get 8 Whirlwind effects. And then, hey, guess what? Patron Warrior is going to be alive and well. Nobody plays Patron anymore. Patron is too slow. And this card never even saw play in the Patron decks because there was just better ways to do it. You know, playing this card and then having to kill it meant that you couldn't consistently determine when the Whirlwind effect was going to happen. And because of that, no reason to play the card. The crazy part is, though, is this was the first card introduced for Whispers of the Old Gods to everybody. And so people were like, oh, this card must be good. This is so cool. And as someone who'd never really played Patron, but I did understand how the mechanics of the deck worked, I was like, this card is not going to work. What are you going to do? You're going to play it and then play your Patron? Like, you can't play your Patron till turn 6. You're not really getting the effect of it that you really want. And it also turns out that, you know, Patrons died a lot of AoE. So the deck ended up dying off, and honestly, nobody really plays Patron anymore. The other reason for that, too, is that Whispers of the Old Gods and Karazhan has created so many good warrior decks that Patron would probably be at the bottom of those warrior decks. So even if it was an effective deck, there's just more warrior decks that are more effective. Dragon Warrior, New Control Warrior with the Ironforge Portal mechanic, C'Thun Warrior, Pirate Warrior, Tempo Warrior, Aggro Warrior. Like, there's so many good warrior decks, and Patron would probably be less effective than all of them. So Tentacle of N'Zoth ended up not seeing play, and once again, our expectations down the drain. All right, moving on. N'Zoth, First Mate. I love this card. When this card first came out, people were like, who cares? Yeah, I get a 1/3 Rusty Hook. Who gives a shit? Like, that's not, so what? Like that's a worse Light's Justice. And to them, I would say, I poo-poo you. You need to think bigger picture. It's a 1/1 body. So we're getting something out on turn 1. We're getting a weapon, which gives us pings to a non-ping class. And it's a pirate. So it eventually became effective in pirate decks. It eventually became effective in tempo. Dragon Warrior will play 2 of these just to get some early game, more early game presence. And like I said, it's an execute enabler. It is an enrage enabler. You know, you got a lot of stuff that this card helps you with. And it just keeps your board presence, and it's another weapon. You know, the more weapons in Warrior, the better. So it ended up being a pretty darn effective card, and it's still seen in Pirate Warrior and more aggressive versions of Temple Warrior and Dragon Warrior to this day. So I think it's a really good card, and in Arena, it kicks ass. So, yeah. Yeah, let's move on. Forbidden Ancient. 1 mana, 1/1. Spend all your mana, gain +1/+1 for each mana spent. So, like, this is one of those cards that originally, when it came out, people were like, OP, 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 oh, it's going to be a 2 of Druid, so good now. Oh, best card ever, I can't believe it. It turns out it's poop. And the reason it's poop is because it's a vanilla minion. And it's essentially understated a little bit at every mana cost. It's a 1 mana, 1/1. It's a 2 mana, 2/2, right? So 1/1s are typically 2/1s or 1/2s. 2 mana, 2/2, that's kind of understated. Most 2 mana cards are 3/2s or 2/3s. So it doesn't really trade effectively with any of those. It's a 3 mana, 3/3, which isn't bad, but ideally you'd want to have a 3/4 or a 2/4. And so it doesn't trade effectively with either of those. It's a 4 mana, 4/4, which is also kind of understated. Most 4 mana creatures have 5 health, or 3/5s. So it trades essentially evenly with that. 5 mana is not too bad. It's a 5/5, which is about okay. You know, there are has been a proliferation of 5/6s at 5 mana, so it's not quite as good. 6 mana, 6/6, that's fine. There's a lot of 6 mana, 6/6s, and that seems to be the sweet spot. 5 mana and 6 mana seem to be the best mana for it. 7 mana, 7/7, not as good. See, now it's getting weaker. There's already 7 mana, 7/8s out there. You know, it just doesn't. You're paying a lot of mana for a body that's not that effective. 8 mana, 8/8. Now, you know, you need your 8 mana cards to like have an effect on the board right away. You know, I could pay 8 mana and get Ragnaros, or I can get pay 8 mana and get the Forbidden Ancient. Lame. 9 mana, 9/9. That's Blood of the Ancient One. That's, you know, too slow. And 10 mana, 10/10. You know, like it doesn't help you in that sense. You are getting an understated minion no matter where you go. And so it has the same problem as Forbidden Shaping, where you're just not really getting the flexibility of the card is great, but you're just not getting something good for the amount of mana that you're putting into it. So Forbidden Ancient ended up seeing some fringe play in the beginning, and now it sees no play. So another one of those cards where expectations were high and ended up sucking. Fiery Bat. 1 mana, 2/1, death rattle, deal 1 damage to a random enemy. I love this card. I loved it when it first came out. I thought it was genius. Once Leper Gnome got nerfed, I was like, this is going to be a 2 of in every Hunter deck. You need an effective card on turn 1. You need to get that tempo early right away. Fiery Bat fills the deal. Plus, it's got the huge toad effect. Deal 1 damage to a random enemy. How many times are you going to slam this into a 3-health minion and then kill it? You know, you're going to kill 3 drops with this thing. Like, it's awesome. And again, I'm surprised how many people thought this card was bad. They're like, 1 health, it's going to get pinged off. Da, 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 da. But even if it does, your opponent is wasting their turn 2 to ping this card. And the other thing you got to realize is there's not that many ping classes, right? There's Mage, there's Druid, and there's Rogue. That's it. You know? That actually have 1 damage that can be directed to something with their hero power. Now, I'm not counting the Zoth First Mate. I'm not counting Light's Justice. You know? So, Fiery Bat a lot of times ended up trading evenly at worst and trading up at best. You know? So, very good card. Like I said, 2 ofs in almost every Hunter deck. Fiery Bat. Excellent card. Bladed Cultist. 1 mana, 1/2 combo, gain +1/+1. Doggone it, I still think this card is good. When it came out, everybody thought it was terrible. And I wanted to like this card. I wanted to do something with it. It is seeing a little bit of play in Aggro Rogue now. And that has come about because Karazhan has introduced some earlier game stuff. But it's still a fringe deck. It's still not that effective. And to be honest, it kind of just gets squeezed out by other cards. You know, it's really great. It's a combo enabler. It is a combo itself. You know, like 1 mana cards in Rogue are really helpful. They're really effective, like I said, for enabling combos. Problem is, though, you know, if you use this as the first part of your combo, then it's just a 1/2. If you try to combo with other stuff, all you get is a 2/3. Like, yay, I'm getting a 2-mana card for 1 mana. I mean, savings? There are just other cards that are more effective. And it absolutely was not seeing a lot of play earlier. And now that Swashburglar is here, which is awesome, one of my favorite cards of Karazhan, Blade of Cult is not seeing play at all. So, I think we're all right on this one. We thought it sucked, and as much as I wanted to make it work, it ended up still sucking. So, moving on. Primal Fusion. Here's an interesting card. 1 mana, gain +1/+1. Give a minion +1/+1 for each of your totems. And those are totems on board. This saw a lot of play when it first came out. Then it stopped seeing play. And then the Wicked Witch Doctor came out for 1/9 in Karazhan, and now it sees play again in a Wicked Witch Doctor hyper totem deck. And so what ends up happening is you play Wicked Witch Doctor, you play Totemic Might, oh my god, I can't believe that spell is actually being played in a deck, and then you play Primal Fusion to summon another totem, and then give one of your totems that's already out there +3/+3. What? So on turn 5, assuming you already have one totem out there, you literally can have a 3/3, a 0/4, and a 3/4 on your board. Like, what? No, not a 3/3, a 3/5, because the totem is 0/2. I mean, that's insane. Like, the tempo you can gain on turn 5, turn 6, with Wicked Witch Doctor and Primal Fusion, it just blows my mind. You know? And then that combos with Thing from Below. And sometimes you can play Thing from Below on turn 5 with all these totems out there and protect your totems. Like, it's a surprisingly effective deck, and I honestly thought Wicked Witch Doctor was not a very good card. But combining it with Totemic Might and Primal Fusion has proved me wrong. So, Primal Fusion. It was good, it was bad, and now it's good again. Who knew? Karazhan, changing things up, man. Changing the meta. On the Hunt, 1 mana. Deal 1 damage, summon a 1/1 Mastiff, which is a beast. So, neat card. You know, it's an Elven Archer that enables beast synergy. And it's a spell, so it helps out for Yawgunload and Yogg-Saron decks. Problem is, though, aside from the Yawg Trap deck, this card is just not seeing play. And to be honest, most people knew this deck, this card was not going to be that good. It was kind of a one-of. It's a neat card. It gives a ping to a non-ping class, but it turns out in Hunters, you don't necessarily care about pings. I mean, it's neat to have, but do you really want to waste a card on a ping? No. It would be really neat if this card gave you a second hero power, which is deal 1 damage, summon a Mastiff. That would be pretty cool. it would probably cost more mana if it did that, but I think that's, or, it, you know, like if it removed the your original hero power and changed it and made this your hero power, I would play that card. I think that would be a neat card. Because then Control Hunter could actually be a thing. Because then you would have a ping and you would have an ability to summon creatures. And then now, all of a sudden, you're getting beast synergy. And then, like I said, Control Hunter could be a thing. So if they made this card cost 4 mana and it changed my hero power into the On the Hunt as my hero power, that'd be cool, and I would definitely play that card. And I would play, you know, On the Hunt Hunter. On the Hunt Hunter. On the Hunter. But right now, just it doesn't see play, and we nailed this one. This one was not thought to be a good card, and it turned out not to be a good card. Journey Below, one mana, discover a Death Rattle card. So this card in a vacuum is good, and I thought it was good from the very beginning. I think everybody kind of thought it was good from the very beginning, because it's just like, one mana, get a Death Rattle, sweet. You know, and because it's Discover, I get to choose. It's perfect. It sets me up for my late game. It goes very well with N'Zoth Rogue, which is still a thing. The problem is, though, N'Zoth Rogue is just not that effective and not as good as the Miracle Rogue versions that are out there. I would say that even it's probably not as good as Reno Rogue and probably not as good as N'Zoth, or excuse me, the Burgle Rogue that has come about because of Karazhan. So the nice part about Journey Below is it's also a combo enabler. It allows you to discover a card, and it's still, it's very much a utility card. Like, you can slip one of these or two of these into any rogue deck and just be happy. You know? Turn 4, Journey Below, and SI7 Agent, boom, done. Like, this card does a lot of work for one mana, and it's still a good card, and it does still see play in a lot of rogue decks. It's just the rogue deck you would most want it to be in, i.e. an Azoth Rogue, it's just not that effective right now. And it's not the fault of the card, it's the fault of Rogue not having enough heals and taking too much damage for N'Zoth Rogue to be an effective thing. Moving on, Evolve. One mana, transform your minions into random minions that cost one more. All right. I would say this card probably has the biggest disparity between what we thought and then what actually ended up happening with the card. So everybody thought this card was going to be bonkers. Like, one mana? Oh my god. It's like paying one mana and then getting like 5 or 6 mana back. Like, it's crazy. You can trade your minions in, and then you can evolve them and stuff. And the problem with Evolve is it ended up being a win more card, because if you had 3, 4, 5 minions on the board, you were probably already winning. And even if you use this card on your totems, you ended up turning your totems into doomsayers way more than you thought that you were going to. And a lot of times, it just kind of ended your turn, and while you had a better board than you did before, you often ended up getting minions that weren't really that much more effective than the minions you already had on the board. So unless you were able to make trades and then play Evolve, this card wasn't really that effective. So it kind of ran into the same problems that Holy Nova has, where you have to have a board already set, and then make good trades, then play the card, then heal your minions. And so it's really hard to get yourself into that particular board state. Most of the time you have somewhere between 1 and 3 minions on the board and that's it. And then evolving them isn't really that effective. And you ended up trying to be greedy, and Evolve ended up not working. However, one night in Karazhan introduced a card called Pantry Spider. It's a 3-mana 1/3, which summons another 3-mana 1/3. So when you evolve them, you get 2 4-drops. Couple that with New Ruby and Prophet. Couple that with Thing from Below. Couple that with Fire Elemental. And all of a sudden, Evolve now has really, really good targets to hit. So what ended up happening is, instead of summoning a bunch of totems, Evolve Shaman ended up playing a bunch of cards that summoned multiple minions, and then in turn allowed you to evolve a lot of minions very quickly. And so the idea was now to just spread out with minions that don't cost one mana, because getting 2 drops ended up sucking, but getting 3, 4, 5, and 6 drops ended up being really good. So that's the plan. So Evolve basically went from super hyped to super bad to finding its place. Now, Evolve Shaman is a thing, but it's not as effective as Aggro Shaman or Midrange Shaman. So it's kind of a level 3 deck for Shaman. So let's move on. Divine Strength. 1 mana, give a minion +1, +2. It's a Paladin card. I thought this card was crap when it first came out. Yes, it gives you the ability to trade, but now you're investing two cards into one creature, one early game creature that's probably going to die. You know, you slap this on a 2/3, it becomes a 3/5. So, you know, a 2-mana card becomes a 4-mana card. So that's kind of nice. And then you trade it in, you know, I mean, it's good. But I would rather, in the early stages of the game, have the attack than have the health. Because this is not a priest card. It's a paladin card. If this was a priest card, this card would be ridiculous. This would be an auto-include. Just getting two health and then being able to heal that minion over and over and over again allows you to get free trades over and over and over again. And then your minion can stay alive for several turns with just a simple 1-2 buff. You know, this is what made, Velen's Chosen so strong. Because you get +2/+4. Wow. So even though that card costs 3 times the mana as Divine Strength, just having a little bit extra attack and a lot more health made creatures really, really good for Priest. The problem is, though, Priest's got power word tentacles, and that card sucks because it's too expensive. Why would you pay 5 mana to get 2/8 worth of stats? Like, that's crazy. I'd just rather play another minion. You know, for 5 mana, I could play a 5/5 instead of a 2/6. It's stupid. So the problem is that Divine Strength went into Paladin, and Paladin is really about getting a bunch of minions on the board as opposed to continually only buffing one minion. It just wasn't effective enough. So Divine Strength, we're right, not that good a card. Ended up not being a good card. Blood to Ichor. 1 mana, one mana, deal 1 damage to a minion. If it survives, summon a 2/2 slime. Reviews were very mixed on this card. People were like, who cares? It's a worse slam. It doesn't draw a card. It gives me a slime. What's the point of this card? I don't like it. However, Blood to Ichor is a ping for a non-ping class, but also it's a ping for a class that wants to damage its own minions. So this card ended up working really great with Acolyte of Pain, and ended up working up really good with Bloodhoof Brave, which we'll see later on. Anything with an enrage mechanic, it worked great with Battle Rage. You could play any minion and play Blood to Ichor, and then now you're drawing 2 cards instead of 1. So it actually could be a cycle if you used it with Battle Rage. Plus, you get a slime, which is nice. You know, it's a minion on the board and it has something to do. It's 1 mana cheaper than Slam, so you can play Grom on turn 9. Boom, Blood to Ichor, and you don't need to get Inner Rage, which a lot of people didn't. Felt like it was less effective than this card because you weren't able to get the minion. Being able to get what amounts to a 2/2 and 1 damage for 1 mana is excellent value. So the mixed reviews on this card were wrong. This is an excellent card, and it's pretty much a 2 of in most warrior decks. All right, moving on to the 2 mana cards. Undercity Huckster. Death Rattle, 2 mana, 2/2, Death Rattle, add a random class card to your hand from your opponent's class. So this is one of the cards that actually inspired this particular video. And the reason I really liked it is because this is enabling Burgle Rogue to be a thing. The idea of stealing cards from your opponent's class, Undercity Huckster is allowing that to happen. Swashburglar on 1, Undercity Huckster on 2, Burgle on turn 3. Now you've got 4 cards from your opponent's class. Awesome. Love it. Great card. Great card. And it's a Death Rattle, so it works in the Zoth Rogue as well. Everybody thought this card was good. They were right. It turns out Undercity Huckster is my jam, and it's in most Rogue decks at this point. The only issue is most Rogue decks, there's no Tier 1 Rogue deck right now. And so Rogue doesn't see a lot of play, but this card does see a lot of play in those decks. Twisted Worgen, 2 mana, 3/1. You know, a lot of people thought this card was going to be good. 3 attack is great. Yeah, the 1 health sucks, but it's stealthed, so it doesn't get attacked. The problem is, though, is Ravaging Ghoul is a thing, and this card dies. And now Maelstrom Portal is a thing, so this card dies. There's just way too many ways to deal 1 damage AoE and kill this card. Same thing with Morose. That's why that card is not seeing a lot of play either. Even though, in theory, it could generate infinite value for you, and it should be a good card. But unless you can buff it, it doesn't see play. Moving on, Twilight Geomancer, 2-mana, 1/4 taunt, Battlecry, give C'Thun taunt, wherever it is. So, the problem is, with C'Thun, you want C'Thun to just kill your opponent. You don't necessarily want it to stay on the board and then get swings in. The nice part about Twilight Geomancer is it would allow your C'Thun to be played earlier, because now your C'Thun deals a bunch of damage, but it also blocks your opponent. But by the time it gets buff enough to where you want to play it, you don't care if it has taunt or not. It's not really that important. And a 2-mana 1/4 with taunt is just kind of a bad card. You know, it doesn't trade up with anything. It absorbs damage, which is good, but it doesn't actually kill anything else. So a lot of times, a 3-2 and a 2-3 trade into it, and then it dies, and that's it. And so, yay, I healed for 5, sort of. But then I'm just not being effective. If this card was a 2-3, I would actually see it play a lot. A 2-3 taunt for 2 mana would be an awesome card. And I would probably play it. But, like I said, Sun Fury Protector doesn't see a lot of play, and that's a 2-mana 2-3 that gives taunt to other stuff, so this card, it's just not that good. But nobody thought it was good, so we definitely nailed it on that one. And even in Reno C'Thun decks, this card doesn't see play. Moving on, Nat the Dark Fisher, 2-mana 2/4. At the start of your opponent's turn, they have a 50% chance to draw an extra card. This is a meme card. This is a troll card. This card is terrible. We all thought it was terrible. It's terrible. Nobody's playing it. Not even in fatigue decks or mill decks. Like, nobody's playing it. Eternal Sentinel, 2-mana 3/2, Battlecry, unlock your overloaded mana crystals. I'm surprised this card is actually not seeing a lot of play. It turns out that overload shaman, like cards that overload you, aren't really seeing a lot of play, like the massive overloads. The only time I'm seeing this card in play is in Control Shaman, that is using Halazeal, Elemental Destruction to heal up, Healing Waves to heal up. And the problem with that deck is that a lot of times it doesn't even do anything on a turn. It just kind of chills. And so being locked out isn't that bad, because it's not like an aggro deck where every turn is so important, and by the time you get to turn 10, you've won or lost. So essentially you only need 10 turns worth of stuff to do. Whereas with a control deck, you want to try to play as long as possible, and the Eternal Sentinel unlocking your overloaded mana crystals is not really that helpful. You know, so many times, by the time you play the Elemental Destruction Halazeal combo, it's turn 8, you lose 5 mana, you go to turn 9, you still have 4 mana. You can still do stuff. You know, playing Eternal Sentinel unlocks those crystals, and it's helpful, but just having Lava Burst ended up being enough. And yeah, it's a 2-mana 3/2 with a nice effect, but surprisingly hard to get to squeeze it in. It's more of a casualty of just Shaman having so many good cards. So people thought this card was good. It is still good. It's hard to find a space to put it in. So I don't think that's symptomatic of the card. I think that's just symptomatic of Shaman being really good. Moving on, Duskbore, 2-mana 4/1 Beast. This card sucks. It gets pinged off. It gets killed way too easily. They just wanted to make a card that had that stat distribution and was a beast. It sucks in Arena. It sucks in Constructed. It sucks. Moving on. All right. Darkshire Librarian. Interesting, interesting card. Blizzard has been trying to make Discard Lock or Disco Lock a thing. And this was one of the cards that was supposed to do it. When it came out, people were like, oh, sweet. Battle Cry, draw a card. Death Rattle, draw a card. How great is that? I get 2 card draws for 2-mana, 3/2? This card is busted. And then they read it again and they go, discard a card? Why would I want to discard a card? And then draw a card? I don't even gain a card. So when this card was created, people were like, well, that means discarding a card is somehow beneficial, right? Well, at the time, it wasn't. because there weren't enough cards that interacted with discarding a card that was a good thing. Succubus wasn't seeing play, and this card wasn't seeing play. However, Karazhan changed that. With the introduction of Malkazar's Imp and the introduction of the Silverware Golem, now you could effectively discard cards and draw cards. So this became, now it actually did become 2 mana, 3/2, draw 2 cards at some point. Draw a card when you play it, and then draw a card when it gets killed. So now it's actually a staple in the Disco Lock deck that has come out, which is a pretty good deck. Its win rate is not quite as good as actual Zoo, and so it's starting to fall by the wayside a little bit. That being said, I think in the next expansion, Blizzard will put out another discard interaction card, maybe something that heals you, I don't know, or summons a copy of the card that gets discarded, something along the lines of a Silverware Golem, and then Disco Lock will be a thing, and it'll be awesome, and I think it's fun. I think it's a really fun deck, if not that effective. So Dark Shadow Librarian ended up being a good card because One Eye and Karazhan introduced cards where Dark Shadow Librarian would be effective. Cult Sorcerer, 3 mana, 3/2, spell damage plus 1. After you cast a spell, give your C'Thun plus 1, plus 1. So when this card first came out, C'Thun was a big thing, and people were very mad because this was the only mage C'Thun card. And they were like, what the fuck? This card's not even that good. Maybe I buff it like once or twice, that's it. Who cares? I'd rather play, Beckoner of Evil, which is coming up. Because then that guarantees me plus 2, plus 2. This thing probably dies before I get any spell damage out there. Turns out, having a 2-mana 3/2 with spell damage is a good card. You don't even need the C'Thun buffing. So, people were really down on this card, but it's found its way in a Tempo Mage now. And just being able to play it and get a little bit of a spell damage bonus, and then just hitting your opponent with spells, turned out to be pretty good. So, this card, like, people were down on it, and now it's a staple in Tempo Mage decks, and it's there. It's a good card, and I like it. Moving on, Bilefin Tidehunter. 2 mana, 2/1, Battlecry, summon a 1/1 ooze with taunt. So, this card ended up seeing some play in Zoo decks, and also seeing play in Evolve Shaman, but has now kind of fallen by the wayside because there's just better cards to play on 2 mana. And it's nice having the 1/1 ooze with taunt. And a lot of times that ended up blocking, one attack. And so in a weird way, you're healing somewhere between 2 and 3 health by having that 1/1 with taunt up there. But both things having 1 health ended up making it just too ineffective. And like I said, Ravaging Ghoul the thing. So kind of clears this card out of the way. It started to see a little bit of play in the Menagerie decks. And unfortunately, like I said, those decks aren't that effective. But I'm still trying, and I will figure out a Menagerie deck that will work, damn it. And when I do, Bilefin Tidehunter will be a part of it. I hope. It may not. But yeah, people were pretty much said this card is probably not going to see a lot of play, but it's like it's on the fringe. Like it's like the 35th best card. You know, it's not enough to make it into your deck, but it could make it into other decks. Moving on, Beckoner of Evil, 2 mana, 2/3, Battlecry, give your C'Thun plus 2 wherever it is. This is one of those weird cards that was in every C'Thun deck when C'Thun decks were a huge thing, and they're not really seen very much in the meta anymore. And when C'Thun was popular, Beckoner of Evil was popular. And now that Karazhan has introduced a bunch of different deck archetypes and decks have become more aggressive and C'Thun decks are not really that effective anymore, this card is kind of dropping by the wayside. And it was already sort of dropping by the wayside because people weren't using it in their C'Thun decks. They would much rather use Disciple of C'Thun and C'Thun's Chosen over Beckoner of Evil. And having that 2-drop into 3-drop into 4-drop combo wasn't really necessary because there were better 2-drops out there. I mean, this is just a vanilla 2/3, and yes, it buffs your C'Thun, but it doesn't do enough on its own to really help your deck. And so it ended up getting swapped out for other more effective cards. in C'Thun decks. And really, its ineffectiveness comes from the fact that Karazhan has introduced more aggressive decks, and decks have gotten more streamlined, and Beckoner of Evil has now just become, you know, C'Thun is falling by the wayside, so Beckoner of Evil is falling by the wayside too. Moving on, Stormcrack. 2 mana, deal 4 damage to a minion, overload 1. Everybody thought this card sucks when it came out. It still sucks. It can't go face. There's almost no point in having it. It's only strictly removal, and it overloads you for 1. It only sees play in Control Shaman, and most of the Control Shamans are cutting that card as well. So we're all right on that one. Stormcrack sucks. Ugh. Little Freudian slip there. I said Shatter sucks. It does suck. Destroy Frozen Minion. A Frozen Minion is basically removed anyway. Why are you going to put this card in your deck? How many fucking Frozen things do you have? They're trying to make Frozen Mage a thing, not Freeze Mage a thing. Frozen Mage a thing. It's not. Moving on. Renounce Darkness. Replace your Hero Power and Warlock cards with another. Classes? The cards cost 1 less. Renounce Darkness is weird. When it first came out, everybody tried it, and they said this card sucks. It lay dormant for a long time, but now there is a Warlock deck that plays 2 minions, Barnes and Yasharaj. And the whole point of the deck is to put a bunch of cards in your deck and then try to either draw Barnes or Renounce Darkness to draw Yasharaj out. And then if that doesn't work, use Renounce Darkness and play a bunch of cheaper cards as another class. That's it. It's a super meme deck. It's kind of effective, but it's mostly for fun. And that's the only thing that Renounce Darkness sees play. So people were like, this card sucks when it first came out. It turns out it does. It's like, why are you playing Warlock anyway? Just, you don't need this card. It's dumb. You know, if it was Renounce something else, you know, Renounce Light, right? If it was Embrace the Darkness for Priest, ooh, I would totally play that. But no, it's just the wrong class. Warlock's hero powers, why you play Warlock? Moving on, Mark of Yasharaj. Give a minion +2/+2. If it's a beast, draw a card. Mark of Yasharaj is allowing for Beast Druid to be a thing. Now, Beast Druid, unfortunately, is a tier 2 Druid deck. You know, you've got Malyog and you've got Ramp Druid ahead of it. But Mark of Yasharaj is a good card in the Beast Druid deck. It is a staple in that deck. It's a 2 of in that deck. So the card is good. People thought it was, but it just wasn't good until Karazhan. Whispers of the Old Gods did not create an effective Beast Druid deck. One Eye and Karazhan did. So Mark of Yasharaj wasn't good until One Eye and Karazhan came out. Alrighty. Moving on. Let's scroll to the bottom, go to the 3 drops here. Alrighty, let's take a look. We've got Embrace the Shadow. Okay, so a few more 2 drops. Embrace the Shadow. 2 mana. This turn, your healing effects deal damage instead. This card everybody thought was garbage coming out. Why don't I play Arcanine Soul Priest? And then I thought about it some more. I'm like, hey, 2 mana to get this effect? That's not bad, you know? That's worth it. You could play this and then slam your Healbot into somebody and deal 8 damage to your enemy hero, excuse me. The problem is it did see some play in antique Healbot decks. It definitely sees play in Wild, where you can pull off some Baron Rivendare and Zombie Chow and antique Healbot combos with Embrace the Shadow. Problem is, though, in Standard, it's just not good enough. And while it did see a little bit of play in a Prophet Velen OTK Priest deck, that deck turned out to not be effective enough and not consistent enough to beat the aggro decks. Moving on, Light in the Darkness. 2 mana, discover a minion, give it +1/+1. This card is just a little too slow, and the mana that you pay for it is a little too much. Getting to discover a minion is great. Giving it +1/+1 is not enough, and spending 2 mana on that discovery is not really worth it. It almost sees play in Control Paladin. It saw a little bit of play in Dragon Paladin and Control Dragon Paladin. But it ends up just not being that effective. You know, there are times where this card saves your ass, and there are just times where this card just sits there and does nothing. And you want your cards to always be doing something. Moving on, 3 mana, 2-2 Twilight Flame Caller, Battle Cry, deal 1 damage to all enemy minions. When this card first came out, I thought it was going to be good. I was like, oh yeah, that's awesome, you know? Board clears for all the little cheapy stuff. It allows me to control the board. Turns out, paying 3 mana for a 2-2, even though it does do 1 damage to everything, it's just not that effective. It too easily was the 29th or 30th best card, and then ended up not seeing play. And Karazhan did not change that. You know, most people would actually rather play something like a Spellslinger or just more burn. You know, mages have become very spell-heavy, very burn-heavy. Cabalist Tome is one of the cards that really swung the tide for that. And Twilight Flamecaller is just, you know, it's a casualty of the fact that there's not that many mages, and it's just not that good a card in Mage. Twilight Elder, 3 mana, 3-4, at the end of your turn, giving your Cthune +1/+1. In Cthune decks, this card does see play. It's a nice, strong body. It's it's got the highest stats for a 3 mana card you could have. So it is a good card in Cthune decks. Cthune decks just aren't really in the meta anymore. So it's more symptomatic of just Cthune not being there than this card being bad. Sword of Darkshire, 3 mana, 3-3. Whenever you summon a 1 health minion, give it Divine Shield. The problem with this card is it's a 3 mana, 3-3. The health is too cheap. It's too easily killed. Very often you'll play it on turn 3 and then it just dies to a 3-2. So it's really hard to actually pull this combo off because of the health. In Aggro Paladin, in Divine Shield Paladin, it does see play and it's a good card. You know, there's been a lot of times where I go Steward of Darkshire on 3, Stand Against Darkness, you know, on 5, and boom, 5-1-1s with Divine Shield. Like, that's pretty good. But the problem is, let's say you pull off that combo on turn 8. Well, you'd rather play Tyrion, or you'd rather play Rag Lightlord. Like, that combo is not really that effective. Yeah, I got a bunch of 1-1s with Divine Shield. Who gives a flying crap? It's just not it's not strong enough. It's just not effective. And 1 health minions, once that Divine Shield is gone, are get wiped out by, you know, Ravaging Ghoul and 1 mana and Maelstrom Portal. You know, Maelstrom Portal killed this card even worse, even though it wasn't really alive. Anyway, moving on. Squirming Tentacle, 3 mana, 2-4 with Taunt. Nobody really thought this card was going to be that good. Nobody really thought it was going to see play. It has seen play in a few Fringe Priest decks. That, like, the Steal Your Stuff Priest, the Thought Steal Mind Vision Priest, actually runs Squirming Tentacle, oddly enough, because it just wants to protect its face. And I slipped it into a Dragon Priest deck, and it was surprisingly effective. Because, you know, that deck is all about just board control and protecting your face until you can get other minions out. And so it uses taunts to protect other more effective minions. And so Squirming Tentacle actually found some play in a Dragon Priest deck that I created. But that's not in the meta. There's one guy playing it, it doesn't count. So, yeah, we're all right. Everyone assumed this card was not bad, but not good enough to see play. You know, 50 deck slots, maybe this card sees play. 40 deck slots, yeah. But, you know, with 30, it's not working. Spawn of the Zoth, 3 mana, 2-2, Death Rattle, give your minions +1/+1. 3 mana is too expensive for this card. It's just too expensive. You know, it's a win more card. It's not seeing play. Everybody thought I wasn't going to see play, and they're right. However, there is a combo that I do want to mention with this card that is really neat. It's Moat Lurker. You can play Spawn in Azoth and then immediately Moat Lurker it, give everything 1-1, and then the Moat Lurker gets 1-1, and then when the Moat Lurker dies, Spawn in Azoth comes out and rebuffs your stuff. So check out that combo if you can. It's worth thinking about. It doesn't happen that often, but I've seen it happen in Arena a couple of times, and it's surprisingly effective. Moving on, Silithid Swarmer. 3 mana, 3/5, can only attack if your hero attacked this turn. Everybody thought this card was garbage. They thought maybe it'd work in Rogue. It turns out it doesn't. Just having your hero attack every turn. Most of the time, you want your hero to attack effectively. You want your hero to be clearing a minion when he attacks. And then that's the only time your Silithid Swarmer gets to attack. And 3/5 honestly is not worth it for those stats. If it was a 4/5 or a 3/6, that would be worth it. But it's only slightly overstatted. But the drawback is so bad, it's just not worth playing. And everyone was right. Ravaging Ghoul, 3 mana, 3/3, Battlecry, deal 1 damage to all other minions. I'm surprised how many people were kind of down on this card. They were like, it doesn't fit Patron, it only deals 1 damage, who cares about that? I'd rather play Unstable Ghoul, because it has Taunt, it comes out 2 mana earlier. But in Standard, this card is ridiculous. This card is a 10 out of 10. 100 out of 100, like, it's in every single Warrior deck, and there's so many times where this is helpful, you know? It enables Executes, it enables Acolyte of Pain, it enables Blood of Brave, all your Enrage cards, it enables Battle Rage, it's so helpful for clearing off little 1-1 minions, and, like, it's an excellent card, and we're all wrong. But we're wrong because we're thinking of it from the perspective of existing Warrior decks. And it turns out that this card was an inclusion. It didn't spawn a deck itself, but it became an inclusion in every single Warrior deck past that. So, excellent card. And yeah, we're wrong. Forlorn Stalker. 3 mana, 4/2. Battlecry, give all Deathrattle minions in your hand +1/+1. I actually thought this card was going to be really good. I thought it was going to enable a Deathrattle Hunter deck, and it turns out Deathrattle Hunter actually is a thing, but it's more of a tempo variety, and this card just doesn't provide you with enough tempo. And the weird part is, too, you want your Deathrattle minions to die, so giving them +1/+1 is kind of counterproductive, and 4/2 stats is just bad. It dies too easily. You know, honestly, if this card was a 3/3, I think it would have seen more play. Or if it was a 3/4, it definitely would have seen more play. Even at 2/4, I think would have been more effective than a 4/2, just because you want it to be able to trade more. And Hunter has a lot of competition at the 3-mana slot, so, like I said, doesn't see play. Disciple of C'Thun, 3-mana, 2/1, deal 2 damage. Battlecry, deal 2 damage, give your C'Thun +2/+2. This card is the card that makes C'Thun decks work. This is the linchpin. People say it's Twin Emperor Veklor, or they say it's C'Thun himself. No, it's this card right here. This card makes C'Thun decks work. If this card did not exist, C'Thun decks would absolutely suck. Yes, they're not really seeing a lot of play, but Disciple of C'Thun is the card that makes them work. And who knew? People thought it was a worse Argent Horse Rider. Turns out it's a significantly better. It's a really good card. And I'd say there are instances where Argent Horse Rider is better, and there are instances where Disciple of C'Thun is better. But it's the go engine. So, yeah, who knew? You know, it seemed like a very simple card and just kind of like, neat. But turned out to be really good. Darkshadow Councilman. Moving on, 3 mana, 1/5. After you summon a minion, gain +1 attack. People thought summon was not the same as play. And so they were like, man, I gotta play a bunch of cards for my hand. No. Anytime a minion comes on board, it gets +1. Once people realize that, they realize this card was good. They realize 5 health is a lot to get rid of on turn 3. It is a staple now in all Zoo decks. And it should be. I thought this card was great. I was like, this card is OP when it came out. You know. Tarion Grub, 3 mana, 2/5, beast, no text. This card needed some text. I don't know. If it could, like, buff itself. Like, every time it just kills a minion, give it +1 health or +1 attack, it would be a really good card. It would see play. Unfortunately, there's so many other 3-mana cards. And much like Forlorn Stalker, it got phased out. And Houndmaster, the idea was to play this and then have a 4/7 with Taunt after you play Houndmaster. But Hunter's not really about protecting its face. It's about attacking your face. So it was better to just play other stuff or just buff your animal companion when it came out. So Carrion Grub is no longer seeing play, but it did see quite a bit of play when it first came out. Bloodsail Cult is 3-mana, 3/4 Battlecry. If you control another pirate, give your weapon +1/+1. So Pirate Warrior is still a thing, though it's not the most effective of warrior decks. And Bloodsail Cultist is the card that allowed Pirate Warrior to come about. So people were really sleeping on this card. I thought it was amazing when it first came out, and to me it still is. It's just Pirate Warrior is not seeing a lot of play, but this card made Pirate Warrior a legitimate deck. So yay Bloodsail Cultist. Amgam Rager, this is a troll card. It sucks. Everybody know it sucks. Moving on. Addled Grizzly, 3-mana, 2/2. After you summon a minion, give it +1/+1. I'm surprised this card didn't take off, because there was already token druid decks that were just play a bunch of stuff, buff a bunch of stuff. But it turns out that Violet Teacher and Power of the Wild was a more effective combo than Addled Grizzly, just because the Addled Grizzly had to be played first and it's 3-mana. If this card was 2-mana and was a 1/2, I think that would actually be better. Because then it would just, it's just so much easier to slide a 2-mana card into a combo than it is to slide a 3-mana card into a combo. Or if this was a 3-mana 2/3, which I think actually would be fine stat-wise, this card would see play. But it's just, it's statted too low. Alright. Moving on, 3-mana Spreading Madness. Deal 9 damage randomly split among all characters. Why are you giving this to Warlock? What's the point of this? Memes? Warlock isn't about hurting itself. You know? So there was a small window where there was a Floating Watcher Reno Spreading Madness deck, but it ended up sucking. So this card sucks, and everybody thought it sucks, and they were right. Moving on, Shadow Strike, 3-mana, deal 5 damage to an undamaged character. Initial thoughts were this was too expensive relative to Backstab, and then people realized that dealing 5 damage for 3-mana, even though it's to an undamaged character, is ridiculous. Shadow Strike very often was killing 5 drops and 6 drops. It's an excellent card. It's usually a 2 of in most rogue decks, and it's a spell, so it enables Gadgets and Auctioneer. I thought this card was great. I couldn't wait to play with the card. I love it. It's still in my rogue decks. Good card. Moving on. Infest. 3-mana. Give your minions Death Rattle. Add a random beast to your hand. Problem is, this is a win more card. And it's 3-mana. And you kind of have to have a board already. And it's meant to sort of refill your hand with beasts. It's just too slow. Hunters play too fast. And we all knew that. And unless you were going to play a control hunter, this card wasn't going to see play, and Control Hunter's not a thing, so bad card. Everybody knew it. Feral Rage, 3-mana, choose one. Give your hero +4 attack, or gain 8 armor. This card is weird, because when it first came out, it saw a lot of play, and then it saw no play. And then once the Mali Yogg-Saron deck came out, that uses the Moonglade Portal, and Feral Rage became just another way to heal yourself or to clear a minion, and also combining it with Fandral Staghelm makes it see play now. So it's weird. When it came out, I thought it was a fairly average card and would probably be a one of, and it saw a ton of play, and then it saw no play, and then now it is seeing play in a very specific deck. So it found its place, but its place was where I thought it was. An average card that's pretty good and will probably be in most decks. So it's in one deck. Moving on, Blood Warriors. 3-mana, add a copy of each damaged friendly minion to your hand. Doggone it, I wanted this card to work so bad. Ravaging Ghoul is a thing. Whirlwind is a thing. You know, you play some big minions, you whirlwind, your Blood Warriors them back. Nope. Too ineffective. Just too slow. Couldn't find a deck slot, and the only deck it might work in was like a Fatigue Warrior, and even then it didn't see play. However, a deck has come out that utilizes the new Arcane Giants that came out in 1-9 and Karazhan. So the idea is to play a bunch of spells, get your Arcane Giants down to 0 mana, play two Arcane Giants, Whirlwind, Blood Warriors, play two more Arcane Giants to have 2 8-7s and 2 8-8s. And then hopefully you charge one of them and you kill them. So that deck has been seeing some play, and it does work. It's just not as effective as the other Warrior decks, and so, like I said, Blood Warriors is kind of falling by the wayside. I still like the card. I still think it will enable a good deck. I don't know what that deck is. Rallying Blade, 3 mana, 3-2, Battlecry, give +1/+1 to your minions with Divine Shield. The problem with Rallying Blade is that it was really hard to play it on turn 3 and still have creatures that still had Divine Shield. It was hard to actually get the buff off. But it's still a 3 mana, 3-2 weapon, so it does see some play in some Paladin decks, but those Paladin decks aren't that effective. I think that's kind of indicative of Paladin in general. It's just, there's not a deck that's good enough to wear Rallying Blade and Steward of Darkshire and all these really neat cards that I want to use these cards in actually will see play and work. Moving on to the 4 mana cards. Zero Poison Mind. 4 mana, 3-2, Battlecry, and Death Rattle. Add a random Toxin card to your hand. I won't go over the Toxin cards, but Zero Poison Mind is an auto-include in Nazoth Rogue, and also in Combo Rogue. And in Miracle Rogue, it also sees play. Everybody thought it was going to be a good card. It's a good card. Yeah. Done and done. Twilight Summoner. 4 mana, 1-1, Death Rattle. Summon a 5-5 Faceless Destroyer. So this card saw a lot of play in Nazoth Paladin initially. It eventually became phased out because people thought it was too slow. It has since made a comeback in Egg Paladin, which is basically a Zooey Death Rattle deck that utilizes this card very effectively. So it doesn't see a lot of play, but it does see play in a deck that is just starting to become popular. Southsea Squidface, 4 mana, 4-4, Death Rattle, give your weapon +2 attack. The problem with this Death Rattle is it's very hard to pull off on a weapon that has 2 durability. And so what ended up happening is you would play this card and then you were trying to hold off to keep your weapon so it could get that Death Rattle onto a 2 durability plus weapon. And the nice part is the Death Rattle, so this card will come back if you play Nazoth. But even in Azoth decks, it ended up not seeing a lot of play. But it is a pirate, and I do like it, and I know there's a pirate rogue deck out there that I can make that will include this deck, include this card. It just hasn't come to fruition yet, but I'm hopeful. Shifting Shade, 4 mana, 4-3, Death Rattle. Copy a card from your opponent's deck and add it to your hand. It's Priest. It should be 3-4. Yes, I know you want it to die and you want to bring it back from the Zoth, but this card doesn't see play, but it does see play indirectly because there are Priest decks that play Museum Curator, and a lot of times Shifting Shade is a nice pick for that. So I don't usually put Shifting Shade in my Priest deck, but I typically choose it when Museum Curator comes out. Polluted Hoarder, 4 mana, 4-2, Death Rattle, draw a card. Too expensive, dies too easily. Yes, it's good stat distribution, it just doesn't see play. You'd rather put the regular Loot Hoarder in because it's 2 mana. 2 mana, 2-1 that dies and draws a card, way more effective than 4 mana, 4-2 that dies and draws a card. Mire Keeper, 4 mana, 3-3, choose one, summon a 2-2 Slimer, gain an empty mana crystal. When people first saw this card, they thought it was amazing. They thought it was an auto include in every druid deck. later on, it stopped seeing play because they were like, too slow, effect not good enough, meh. And then later on, Ramp Druid and Arcane Giant Druid became a thing with Yogg and Maligos in it. And Mire Keeper is now seeing play again because it's like, hey, I need the ramp. And I want the body, and I want the flexibility, and it's really good with Fandral. So it's weird. Like it people thought it was really good, and then people thought it sucked, and then now people think it's okay. And honestly, when I first saw the card, I was like, it's good. It's okay. It's good for its mana cost, and I like it. So it pretty much ended up right where I thought it was going to be. Moving on, Midnight Drake. 4 mana, 1/4, Battlecry gain plus 1 attack for each other card in your hand. 4 health on turn 4 is bad. I would much rather play an Azure Drake than play a Midnight Drake. And this card was just one of those cards where, hey, look, it's the opposite of a card that everybody likes. It does not see play. The only thing that this could be in, and I have seen this work maybe twice, is Bran, Midnight Drake, Charge, OTK. So, you play Thorisin, you Bran becomes 2 mana, Charge becomes 2 mana, Midnight Drake becomes 3 mana, and then on turn 7, you OTK them. I've seen it happen. It's not that effective, because you kind of already want to have played stuff, but it ends up being a fairly effective finisher in a tempo-oriented Dragon Warrior deck with OTK possibilities. So I have seen it happen, and I think it can be a cool combo. You know, even if you play it with Bran, and this becomes like a 10-4, you give it charge, and then it's now has 12. You know, now you got a 12 charge for 7 mana. You know, it can even play it on turn 10, so it becomes just as good as a charge with Grom in that sense. So, Midnight Drake, not a bad card. People just haven't used it yet. Moving on, Master of Evolution. 4 mana, 4/5, Battlecry, transform a friendly minion into a random one that costs 1 more. Everybody thought this card was the jam. They said it was better than Evolve because you can choose, and it still doesn't see play. It doesn't even see play in Evolve Shaman, which is weird. I don't know why this card isn't good. It should be good. It should be an auto-include, but yeah, I don't know. It doesn't see play. And I think it doesn't see play is because of this bad boy up here, the 4-mana 7-7. It's like, why would I play this when I could play this? Like, I get it. I wouldn't want to play it either. Klaxley Amberweaver, 4-mana 4-5, Battlecry. If your C'Thun has at least 10 attack, gain plus 5 health. It is awesome in C'Thun Druid. C'Thun Druid is not an awesome deck. Yeah, moving on. 4-mana 3-3, Infested Wolf, Death Rattle, summon 2/1/1 spiders. This is pretty much a staple in most tempo-oriented, face-oriented aggro decks, but it's weird because it's not really an aggro card. Really what it does is it guarantees you board presence and guarantees a beast on the board, so your kill commands are more effective. I like it. It's a Death Rattle card. I think it's neat. Death Rattle Hunter is a thing. It's just not N'Zoth Death Rattle Hunter. Anyway, moving on. Infested Tauren. 4-mana, 2/3, Taunt Death Rattle. Summon a 2/2 slime. When this card first came out, everybody thought it was the Sludge Belcher replacement. They're like, 2-mana, 2/3, that summons a 2-mana, 2/2 slime with Taunt? That's hella good! We'll totally play it! If the slime had Taunt, yeah. It'd be hella good. In fact, this might cost 5 mana if the slime had taunt. It doesn't. The weird part is, though, this is the only Death Rattle card that also has taunt that isn't Chill Maw that you can play in an N'Zoth deck. And so, oddly enough, people thought the card was great when they first saw it. They thought it really sucked after they read it and understood the card. But now it sees play. And you know, a lot of cards are like that, you know? I thought the card was very much average when I first saw it, and it turns out it is very much average, but it's good enough to see play in N'Zoth decks, because you just, when you summon N'Zoth, you just need some taunts. And this is a taunt. It sees some play in N'Zoth Paladin, it sees some play in N'Zoth Rogue. You know, it's found its place. It's got a niche and it filled it. Hooded Acolyte, 4-mana, 3/6. Whenever a character is healed, give your C'Thun +1/+1. I thought this card was pretty garbage when it first came out. I thought that C'Thun Priest... If any C'Thun deck was going to be effective, I thought C'Thun Druid was going to be number 1. I thought C'Thun Warrior was going to be number 2. And I thought C'Thun Priest was going to be number 3. It turns out C'Thun Priest is not even as effective as C'Thun Mage or C'Thun Warlock. And the reason is because you can't go above 30 health. And so Hooded Acolyte, much like the Twilight Darkmender, which you're going to get to, just doesn't see play because C'Thun Priest is not a thing. It's just not effective. All right. Flame Wreath Faithless, 4 mana, 7/7. This card is a meme. It's so good, it's a meme. Overload 2, 4 mana, 7/7. You gotta be kidding me. How is this a card? This card is so good, it's ridiculous. The crazy part is, though, it doesn't actually see as much play as I thought. The problem with the card actually is the overload. When you play this card, you only have 3 mana the following turn, and a lot of times you end up playing... what's the card? The card where you summon 2/3 spirit wolves. Feral Spirits. So a lot of times what happens is you play Flame Wreath Faces on 4, and then you play Feral Spirits on 5, and then you're still overloaded. So this overload actually comes at a pretty bad time. If you play this on 4, you can't Doomhammer. That's the hard part. Is it ends up destroying your Doomhammer turn on turn 5. But still a very good card, still effective. It still does see play, just a little bit less than I thought. I figured this would be an auto-include no matter what kind of Shaman you're playing. But there are Shaman decks that just don't play this card. So, who knew? Vandril, Staghelm, 4 mana, 3/5. Your choose one cards have both effects combined. Awesome card. Everybody thought it was going to be awesome. Everybody thought it was going to be amazing. It is amazing. Being able to have your choose one cards combo is ridiculous. Just playing Fandral and then Raven Idol is ridiculous. Yeah, excellent card. It's included in every Druid deck, as it should be. Faceless Shambler, 4 mana, 1-1. Battlecry, copy a friendly minion's attack and health. Friendly minion. That's why this card sucks. Goddamn. I wanted this card to be good. Another faceless combo card, this should be good. Friendly minion means you have to have something on the board already, and then you copy it. God damn it, man. You know, so Faceless Shambler saw a lot of play in the beginning. It saw no play for a long time. Now it sees a little bit of play in giant decks. But that's it. Not really effective. Again, not really seeing play. Too bad, really. I like this card, but oh well. Evolve Cobalt, 4 mana, 2/2, spell damage, +2. Why is this a 2/2? Everybody thought this card would suck. It sucks. Yes, spell damage is great. 4 mana is too expensive to get that spell damage. It's not effective. It has seen a little bit of play in very fringe Freeze Mage decks, but nobody cares. Moving on, Eater of Secrets, 4 mana, 2/4, Battlecry, destroy all enemy secrets, gain +1/+1 for each. This card was meant to be the killer of Secret Paladin, but it turns out that Standard was the killer of Secret Paladin. Eater of Secrets has seen no play. Then the One Eye of Karazhan came out, and they were really trying to push secrets again. They created the Avian Watcher, they created the Cloaked Huntress, and a lot of people thought, hey, Eater of Secrets might make a comeback. Those decks haven't really been that effective, and Eater of Secrets has not really seen play. It is a tech card, but it's just a tech card that... It's just... The secret decks aren't powerful enough to require you to put in Eater of Secrets. It's not like before where, you know, because Dr. Boom was so prevalent... Big Game Hunter became a standard card, so you could kill the 7/7. Secret decks aren't effective enough for Eater of Secrets to see play. Demented Frostcaller, 4 mana, 2/4. After you cast a spell, freeze a random enemy. God damn it, this is too expensive. It's too expensive. If this was 3 mana, it would see play right along with the Flame Waker. Ugh. Blizzard, what were you thinking, man? Did you really think freezing guys was that effective of a thing? It's not. It's really not. And the stats are just too low. It just dies too easily. Cyclopean Horror. 4 mana, 3/3. Taunt, battle cry, gain +1 health for each enemy minion. Your opponent needs to have 2 minions on the board for this to be as effective as a Senjin Shieldmaster. If they have more minions on the board, this thing becomes less and less and less effective. If I played this against one minion, I would have a 4-mana 3-4. That's understated. But I'd be only up against one minion. So in theory, the two could battle, and I would have Taunt. Not a bad situation. If he has two minions on the board, I'm playing Ascendant Shieldmaster. Well, depends on what those minions are. I might get a 2-for-1 trade, I might not. The problem is if he has three minions, four minions, five minions on the board, this card just gets eaten up by those minions and becomes less and less effective the more minions he has. But coincidentally, that's how this card gains power, is by the opponent having more minions. So if this card was a 3-3, it'd be really good. Or if it was a 3-mana card, it'd be really good. It'd be excellent. I would love this card. It's 4-mana. It's too expensive. Caduceus Chosen, 4-mana, 4-2, Divine Shield, Battlecry. Give your C'Thun +2/+2. This, along with the Disciple of C'Thun, make C'Thun decks go. It's an excellent card. Everybody thought it was an excellent card. It works, but like I said, C'Thun decks, not in the meta. Bloodhoof Brave, 4-mana, 2-6, Taunt and Rage, +3, Attack. This card saw so much play initially that Stampeding Kodo became a thing in a lot of decks just to kill this card. Eventually, this card became too slow and did not fit the aggro, tempo-oriented warrior decks, and has since become replaced with Ironforge Portal in the control decks. So, oddly enough, while I think Bloodhoof Brave is an amazing card, it's just not seeing a lot of play. And it's just because the deck archetypes that are out for Warrior now don't utilize Bloodhoof Brave. Bloodhoof Brave was a card that you built around initially. You know, there is a sort of a Taunt Warrior, Bolster Warrior out there, and Bloodhoof Brave is pretty good in that deck, but it's just not seeing a lot of play anymore. Which is weird, because I do think it's an excellent card. Blackwater Pirate, 4-mana, 2-5, your weapons cost 2 less. Well, it's a pirate. It's a pirate that doesn't see play in pirate decks. So it sucks. Everybody thought it sucked. It does suck. Aberrant Berserker, 4-mana, 3-5, enrage, +2 attack. Why is it +2? It should be +3. Right? The Amani Berserker is +3. Why is this not +3? Well, they wanted to cap it off at 5 attack, that's why. And because they wanted to cap it off at 5 attack, nobody plays it. It sucks. It does kick ass in Arena, though. Shadowward Horror, destroy all minions with 2 or less attack. Why is it all minions? It should be enemy minions. Enemy minions! 4-mana! If this is 3-mana, alright, destroy my minions. That's fine. That's a reasonable drawback for this card. 4-mana? This is stupid. Terrible card. Everybody thought it was terrible. It's still terrible. Validated Doomsayer, 5-mana, 0-7. At the start of your turn, set this minion's attack to 7. This is a win more card. If you're ahead, then you can play this card and it might live. If you're behind, this card dies. And it dies for free. And you just wasted 5-mana. So, everybody thought it was not going to see play, and they're right. 5-mana, Usher of Souls. 5-mana, 5-6. Whenever a friendly minion dies, give your C'Thun +1/+1. I cannot believe this. I can say this. A 5-mana, 5-6 in a C'Thun deck. In a C'Thun Reno deck. Does not see play. I just don't get it. It seems like a good card, but it's just not good enough. It doesn't see play. It's not even the 30th of best card. I don't get it. But it isn't. Twilight Darkmender, 5-mana, 6-5. If your C'Thun has at least 10 attack, restore 10 health to your hero. Same problem with the Hooded Acolyte. C'Thun Priest sucks. This card in turn sucks. But in and of itself, it's a good card. You know, C'Thun Priest, they just never made an effective C'Thun Priest. I don't know. I'm going to experiment with it more. I think I can make an effective C'Thun Priest. I don't know. I like Priest. I don't know why I like Priest. I hated Priest for a long time. But I've come around to it over the last year or so. Just the challenge of making a Priest deck that works interests me. Anyway, Shadowcaster. 5 mana, 4/4. Choose a friendly minion. Add a 1/1 copy to your hand that costs 1. Shadowcaster hasn't seen a lot of play except for one deck, the Infinite Rogue. It's not a thing. It's not in the meta, but it's a really neat deck. You play Bran Bronzebeard. You play Shadowcaster. You Shadowcaster Bran, and then you get 2 copies of Bran, and then you Shadowcaster your Shadowcaster, and you get 2 Shadowcasters, and then you can do an infinite loop. It's really hard to pull off, but when it does get pulled off, it's awesome. And you can end up, this deck, what it does is it tries to get Ragnaros down, and then does the infinite Shadowcaster on Ragnaros and gets 10 Ragnaroses, and then they all hit your opponent in the face and you win. It's a very dramatic way to win, but it's very hard to pull off. So it's more of a meme deck, but I think Shadowcaster actually is a good card, and I do think that there are decks that can utilize it. Those decks are really slow, and it's hard for rogues to play slowly. That's the problem. They just don't have enough tools to keep themselves alive. And Shadowcaster is one of those cards that needs time in order to be effective. Servant of Yogg-Saron, 5 mana, 5/4. Cast a random spell that costs 5 or less. Targets chosen randomly. This card is garbage. Everybody thought it was garbage. It is garbage. Coincidentally, I played a game at rank 6 the other day, and someone had Servant of Yogg-Saron in their deck. They lost. Servant of Yogg-Saron came out and fireballed itself. 5 mana, 3/4, Psychotron, Taunt with Divine Shield. This card is a little too expensive. It should be like 4.5 mana. 5 mana is too much. Yes, I know it's -1/-1 compared to a Sunwalker, but 3/4 is just not strong enough. It gets killed too easily. It trades down with so many things at 5 mana. You know, you ping it and you run your 5/5 into this thing and there you go, you know. I just wish it did more, because I do like the card. I think it's neat. And it's boss in Arena. It's just not good and constructed. Princess Huron. 5 mana, 6/5, Battlecry, trigger a friendly minion's death rattle effect. I thought this card was ridiculous when I first saw it. I was like, what the fuck? It's overstatted for 5 mana? And the Battlecry doesn't even matter if you don't pull it off. But then Infested Wolf came out, and Savannah Highmane's already there, and Kindly Grandmother is a thing. You know, there's like a lot of really good death rattles that are available for Princess Huron to hit. It still doesn't see a lot of play. I just don't get it. It blows my mind. It has Savannah Highmane stats for 1 less mana. Like, why isn't it included? And it's a legendary, so it's not like you need to put 2 of them in there. I have it in my Death Rattle Tempo Hunter deck, and it does work. It's just not seeing a lot of play. Hunters are very divided now. They're either all face, or they're mid-range, or they're spell, lock and load, Yogg-trappy, meme-y decks. And Princess Huhuran does not quite fit into any of those. So it's just not seeing a lot of play. Halaziel the Ascended, 5 mana, 4/6. Whenever your spells deal damage, restore that much health to your hero. Excellent card for Control Shaman. Control Shaman is just not that good right now. It's pretty good. It's somewhat effective. It's just not as good as... The problem is Aggro Shaman has such a huge impact on the meta right now that it's kind of keeping all other Shaman decks down. So it's like, why would you play Control Shaman when you could play Aggro Shaman? And why would you play Halaziel the Ascended when you can play Doomhammer? So, excellent card. It plays in an archetype that isn't seeing a lot of play right now. Dark Speaker, 5 mana, 3/6, Battlecry, swap stats with a friendly minion. This should be a 4 mana card. If this is a 4 mana card, I would be a 2 of in every deck. 5 mana is too expensive. The Battlecry is so neat. It's so effective. Right, you could power overwhelming something, slam it into something, and then Darkspeaker it and keep the stats. That's incredible to me. You could 3/6, you could play this on a totem and buff your totem and give it charge. It's basically 5 mana, 3/6 charge. That's got to be good for something. It just doesn't see play. I don't know. Darkshire Alchemist, 5 mana, 4/5. Battlecry, restore 5 health. This is a very good card. It's a good priest card. It doesn't see play. Like I said, that's more an effect of just priest not having good decks than this card being bad. But to be honest with you, I have trouble fitting it into my priest decks. I don't know why. Cult Apothecary, 5 mana, 4/4. Battlecry, for each enemy minion, restore 2 health to your hero. I thought this card was terrible when it first came out. The more minions your opponent has, the more you need the healing, but the more likely it is he's just going to wipe out whatever healing you just did, and now you're left with a 4/4 body. It saw a lot of play in control decks in the beginning. It saw no play later on. It's starting to make a comeback in Reno, N'Zoth Rogue. It's starting to make, you know, like I thought it was going to fit into Freeze Mage, and doesn't fit in Freeze Mage. Its effect is just not quite good enough to see play. And I had thought it might fit into the N'Zoth Paladin as a source, another source of healing, but Ivory Knight has since replaced it there. Crazy Worshipper, 5 mana, 3/6. Taunt, whenever this minion takes damage, give your C'Thun +1/+1. I had thought that this is when +1/+1 for every point of damage, and I was wrong. It's whenever it takes damage. So if it takes 6 damage, it gives +1/+1. If it takes 1 damage, it gives +1/+1. Not quite as good as I originally thought. Still not a bad card. It's just a little too expensive for C'Thun decks. Although it does see some play in C'Thun Warrior. Corrupted Healbot, 5 mana, 6/6, Death Rattle, restore 8 health to the enemy hero. Restoring 8 health to the enemy hero is not worth one extra attack. It saw some play in Embrace the Shadow Priest decks, but those decks have proven ineffective. It does not see play anymore. And unfortunately, it's a mech, so mech synergy is out the door as well. Send Against Darkness, 5 mana. Summon 5, 1/1 Silverhand Recruits. Okay, a 5 mana 5/5 is slightly understated for its own mana cost. And summoning 5, 1/1 Silverhand Recruits is typically not effective. Yes, it does fill the board. It's just too expensive. If this was 4 mana, it'd be great. If it was like Muster for Battle and give you 5/1/1s and a hammer, it would be excellent. But as written, it sucks. And it saw a little bit of play in Flood Paladin decks, but again, there's no effective Paladin decks. Power Tentacles, 5 mana, give a minion +2/+6. This card is a meme. It's terrible. It doesn't see play. It's overcosted. Well, why, Blizzard? Why? Just, no. Cabalist's Tome, 5 mana, add 3 random mage spells to your hand. I am shocked at how many people were down on this card. I thought it was an excellent card. I'm like, what the fuck? I pay 5 mana, I get 3 random spell cards? I'm gaining two spells? And I'm replacing this card with a spell that is actually more effective? Like, this is great. A control mage would use this. Even a tempo mage would probably use this. And it didn't see play for a long time. Like I said, people did think it was slow. And with the advent of Reno Mage and Control Mage decks that have been coming out recently, thanks to One Night in Karazhan, Cabalist Tome is now seeing a lot of play. So, yeah, the card is effective, and I always thought it was effective, and it turns out I was right. So, I'm going to pat myself on the back for that one. All right, moving on. Tentacles of Arms, 5 mana, 2/2. Death Rattle returns to your hand. This card sucks. Everybody thought it sucks. It turns out it sucks. Yeah, it does not see play. Hammer Twilight, 5 mana, 4/2, Death Rattle, summon a 4/2 elemental. Why would you play this when you could play Doomhammer? Is the thing that everybody has said, and that's why this does not see play. And nothing that Karazhan could do would make this see play. Except it does see play as a one of in Crazy Evolve Shaman, because the elemental that comes out is a 3-drop and can get evolved into a 4-drop. So, Thing from Below, 6 mana, 5/5, Taunt, costs 1 less for each totem you've summoned this game. Wow. Everybody thought this card was going to be great when it first came out, and it turns out it's great. It's a 2-of in every shaman deck. Doesn't matter the shaman deck. All you do is summon totems, and you drop this thing for 0 mana. Wow. So good. 5/5 taunt. Oh, God. Yeah, I mean, 10 out of 10. Like, this card is why Shaman is so OP right now. This card. Not Doomhammer. Not the 4-mana 7-7. This card. Scarab Cult's a 6-mana 7-6. Battlecry, give your C'thun +2/+2. On 6-mana, I don't want to give my C'thun +2/+2 anymore. I don't really care about buffing it anymore. I want to start dropping minions and going face and preparing for C'thun's arrival. A 6-mana 7-6 dies too easily, and everybody agreed that it was probably the worst of the C'thun buff cards, and it has never seen play and probably never will. Scale Nightmare, 6-mana 2-8. At the start of your turn, double this minion's attack. I thought there was going to be a Conceal Scaled Nightmare Rogue. Play a Scaled Nightmare. Play Cold Blood. Make this a 6-8. Conceal it. And then smash your opponent for 12 on the next turn. Those dreams never came to fruition. It's just too slow. 6 mana is too much to pay for this card. The effect is awesome, and I think the effect, it's similar to Gazrilla, but even Gazrilla doesn't see play. Well, mostly because he rotated out, but man, I miss Gazrilla. That card was awesome. And with all the cool pings that they have now, man, Gazrilla can be really good, but what can you do? Nubian Prophet, 6-mana 4-4. At the start of your turn, reduce this card's cost by 1. This card got a lot of hype when it first came out, and then people realized that having a 4-4 sit in your hand for 6 turns, not really helpful. By the time you get it down to 2 mana or 0 mana, you don't really need a 4-4 anymore. 3-mana 4-4 isn't bad, but it's just hard to find a slot for this card. It does see play in Evolve Shaman, and it is one of the best arena cards ever made. But yeah, as far as Constructed goes, kind of poopy. Mukla, Tyrant of the Veil, 6-mana 5-5, Battlecry, add 2 bananas to your hand. 6 mana is too much to pay for this card. Getting 2 bananas is not that helpful, and I want to do more with my 6-mana cards. And it's not that Mukla, Tyrant of the Veil, is bad in and of itself. It's just bad relative to the other 6-mana cards that are right next to it. Yeah, so it doesn't see play. But it is a beast, and it might see play in Paladin, in like Zoo Paladin, Menagerie Paladin, or other Menagerie Druid, stuff like that. Harold Village, 6-mana 5-5. Battlecry, summon a 1-1 copy of each of your other minions. Why is this a priest card? Priest has so much trouble having minions stay on the board. Harold Village, the thing that it copies, if it stayed alive for that long, then you probably already won. So Harold Village was a win more card, and people have been trying to make it work, and it doesn't work. And nothing in Karazhan has made it work since then. The only thing I could see it maybe working in would be some sort of Nazoth Death Rattle priest. But that's it. And even then, no. It's better just to play Barnes, frankly. Faceless Summoner, 6-mana, 5-5, Battlecry, summon a random 3-cost minion. People were up in arms when this card came out. They're like, this card is too good, it's going to be a 2 of in every mage deck, this is ridiculous, mage is already good, it doesn't need this. These were arena concerns. And in arena, it's great, but now it's not in arena anymore because they took it out. But it's still an excellent card, and it still sees play in a more minion-oriented tempo mage decks. And I think it's excellent. Yeah. You know, I mean, the card's obviously good. I mean, how could it be bad? 6-mana, 5-7, Dark Arakoa, Taunt, Battlecry, give your C'thun +3/+3. This card, surprisingly enough, has seen play outside of C'thun decks. In Ramp Druid, it actually does see a lot of play. Surprisingly enough, Moonglade Portal and Dark Arakoa have become staples in a ramp-style, big-buff taunt druid that is seeing more and more play recently. So it's a good card. Everybody thought it was a good card. Still a good card. And if C'Thun Druid was more effective, I think it would see more play. But as of right now, it doesn't see a lot. But still an excellent card. Corrupted Seer, 6 mana, 2-3. Battlecry, deal 2 minions to all non-Murloc minions. Weirdly enough, Corrupted Seer saw no play in Murloc decks. It's too slow. Oddly enough, though, it has seen some play in some control decks, and has also seen some play in some curator decks. So, Corrupted Seer, finding its place. Ancient Harbinger, 6 mana, 4-6. At the start of your turn, put a 10-cost minion from your deck into your hand. It should say 10-cost card. I would play this in a Anything Can Happen deck. But it says minion, so it's too slow. And the stats are bad for 6 mana. And it says at the start of your turn, so this card has to live, and it usually doesn't. Thistle T, 6 mana, draw a card and add 2 extra copies of it to your hand. If this was 6 mana, draw 3 cards, I still don't think it would be very good. But 6 mana, draw a card and add 2 copies of it to your hand is worse. I don't know what the card is. It might be a card I don't actually want 2 extra copies of. Why would I play this? It has seen a little bit of play in Miracle Rogue because you can prep it out. Prep Thistle Tea is pretty good because a lot of times you end up getting, you know, 3 Eviscerates or even 3 Auctioneers or, you know, in that deck, getting 3 of something is usually pretty good. But for the most part, it's just too expensive. Moving on to the 7 mana card. 7 mana, 4, 6, Taunt, Twin Emperor, Vec'lore. Battlecry, if your C'Thun has 10 attack, summon another Emperor. Emperor 7. This is the other card that makes C'Thun decks go. Disciple of C'Thun, C'Thun's Chosen, and Emperor Vec'lore. Without Emperor Vec'lore, C'Thun would not go. But because it's there, it does go. It is a auto-include in every C'Thun deck, but like I said, C'Thun decks are just not that effective right now. Malkorok, 7 mana, 6-5. Battlecry, equip a random weapon. A lot of people were down on this card. They thought it was too expensive. But I would argue that most weapons cost somewhere between 2 and 4 mana. Or, excuse me, 2 and 7 mana. Gore Howl and Glad's Longbow are a thing. I guess, I'm sorry, 1 and 7 mana. I don't think there's any 8 mana weapons. So, on average, your average weapon cost is about 3 mana. So, if you think about it that way, you're paying 4 mana to get a 6-5 and 3 mana to get a weapon. That's pretty good. How could that be bad? I like it. The problem is, though, is when they make combo cards like this, for instance, Bookworm, which is a 6 mana 3-6, where if you're holding a dragon, you can cast Shadow Word Pain, they do the math too simply, in my opinion. So, in their minds, they're like, 3-6, okay, that's worth about 4 mana, and Shadow Word Pain is worth 2 mana, so if we put the two together, that makes 6 mana, this is a 6 mana card. No. When you combine two things into one card, you actually want to discount it a little bit. And the reason is because the mana cost becomes too high for the effectiveness of the effect that comes out. And so really what you're paying for, you're paying an extra cost in a sense that you're doing the effect on a turn where it's not that effective. I would love to equip a random weapon on turn 5. Or turn 6 even. Turn 7, which starts getting a little late. Bookworm. I would love to cast Shadow Word Pain on turn 3 or turn 4, right? If it was a 4 mana 2-3 cast Shadow Word Pain, I would play that. 4 mana 3-4 cast Shadow Word Pain. Even a 5 mana 3-4 cast Shadow Word Pain. I think I would probably play. 6 mana? It's too slow. It's just too slow. And so that's one of the problems with Malkorok, and that's why it's not seeing a ton of play, although it does see play in Dragon decks, Dragon Warrior decks. It's just a little too slow. A little too slow. Hogger, Doom of Elwyn. 7 mana, 6/6. Whenever this minion takes damage, summon a 2/2 null with taunt. 6/6 is terrible stats. 7 mana, 6/6. It's just the stats are too poor. It doesn't see play. However, I did play a priest deck that used this along with Wild Pyromancer and Power Word Shields to set up a giant wall, and then they kept healing it and played Circle of Healing over and over and over again on this guy. And it was really, really hard to bust through everything. So there is a deck out there that can make use of this card. It's just not effective use of the card. Moving on, set of mana, 5/5, Grotesque Dragonhawk with Wind Fury. We already have a card, a 6 mana 4/5 with Wind Fury, the Wind Fury Harpy. It sucks. This card also sucks. It's a beast. And I had done some experiments with a Emperor Thorison, Tundra Rhino, Grotesque Dragonhawk combo, which when it got reduced would put the Grotesque Dragonhawk at 6 mana, and then the Tundra Rhino at 4 mana. And so then on 10 mana, I could play both of them and deal 12 damage. Seems neat. Why don't I just play Call of the Wild and turn 8? It's a dream. I want this card to be good. It's just not. Cho'Gall. 7 mana, 7/7. Battlecry. The next spell you cast this turn costs health instead of mana. When this card came out, everybody thought it was going to be amazing. They were like, oh my god, auto-include. Turns out waiting for 7 mana as a warlock is too slow. And in Reno decks, there's not enough good spells to make Cho'Gall really effective. The only spell it works pretty well with is Karazhan. And that, including that card and this card, just to pull off a combo, is not really good because neither one of them are that good individually. So doesn't see play. Bog Creeper, 7 mana, 6/8 with Taunt. This is an excellent arena card. It is one of the most ridiculous arena cards ever. It has seen some play in what's called the Bog Champ card deck that Frodan made popular when he played in a tournament, and I believe made it to the semifinals with it. The problem is it's just too vanilla, and it really only goes into like a Ramp Druid deck, or like I said, the Pog Champ deck for Shaman, which plays this, and then plays, I forgot the name of the card, I think it's Ancestral Spirit, where it gives the card Death Rattle, resummon the minion. So it becomes very hard to bash through this minion. But still, it's a good card. It's just hard to find deck space for it. 7 mana, 6/6, Ancient Shield Bearer, Battle Cry. If your C'Thun has at least 10 attack, gain 10 armor. This is a staple in C'Thun Warrior. Everybody thought it was going to be a staple in C'Thun Warrior. It turns out it is. It's a good card. Not much to say. Moving on. Wisps of the Old Gods, 7 mana. Choose 1. Summon 7 1/1 Wisps, or give your minions +2/+2. This saw some play in Fandral token decks. It has since kind of fallen out of favor. I still think it's a good card. It's just 7 mana is so expensive. And very often you want to use it for the 2/2 and not for the 1/1, and then it becomes a win more card. However, if you can get Fandral to stick on the board, this card is ridiculous. Boogie Monster, 8 mana, 6/7. Whatever this attacks and kills a minion, gain +2/+2. And there lies the problem. Attacks and kills a minion. If they just removed that right there, this card would be excellent. Whenever this kills a minion, gain +2/+2. If that's what it said, I would play this card. I'd drop it, I'd taunt it up. It'd be part of like a handlocky deck or something like that. But unfortunately, it sucks. It doesn't see play. Ragnaros the Light Lord. 8 mana, 8/8. At the end of your turn, restore 8 health to a damage-friendly character. Excellent card. Everybody thought so. Everybody knew it. Play this card, heal for 8. If it sticks around, it heals for more. Very often, Rags sticks around for two or three turns, and the best part is, it can attack! It can attack! You can direct your 8 damage wherever you want. Excellent card. Cease playing Paladin decks. Honestly, all Paladin decks would be terrible if it weren't for this card. Giant Sandworm, 8 mana, 8/8. Whenever this attacks and kills a minion, it may attack again. Too slow. Too slow. I'd rather play Call of the Wild. I don't want to play this card. Too slow. Eldritch Horror, 6 mana, 6/10. 8 mana. No text. Too slow. Too slow. Too much mana. Doomcaller, 8 mana, 7/9. Battlecry, give your C'Thun +2 wherever it was. If it's dead, shuffle it into your deck. This card, everybody thought was too expensive. And it saw a lot of play initially, and then it saw no play. But now it sees play in what's called the K3 deck, which basically plays this card and Bran Bronzebeard. And then when C'Thun dies, it summons two more C'Thuns and then uses those C'Thuns to wipe you out. I think it's actually a good card, and I would put in my C'Thun decks more. But it only sees play in the C'Thun Warrior version of that deck. Anomalous, 8 mana, 8/6, Death Rattle, deal 8 damage to all minions. This card is terrible. Why would I want to kill everything? If it dealt 8 damage to all enemy minions, I would play it. Then it's a fucking Flame Strike in a body. Now it's a Twisting Nether in a body. Why would I want to do that as a mage? And it's a Death Rattle. It's a Death Rattle. So I have no control. I can't control this. That's why it sucks. It sees no play. Everybody knew it sucked. It sucks. Call of the Wild. 8 mana, summon all 3 animal companions. Everybody thought this card was going to be great. It is still great. It is a staple in Hunters. It's the only reason Hunters even see play in this meta. This will be an auto-include in every Hunter deck till the end of time. Or at least until Whispers of the Old Gods gets rotated out. So about the Slitherer. 9 mana, 5/9, taunt, can't be targeted by hero powers or spells. Excuse me, by spells or hero powers. 9 mana is too slow. I know what they were thinking. They were like, well, Captured Jormungar is a 5/9, and since we're adding this ability, we're adding taunt and, I don't know what you want to call it, spell proof or something like that. We need to add 1 mana for each of those, so it's a 9 mana card. It's too slow. It's too slow. If this was 8 mana or 7 mana, it would absolutely see play. 9 mana is too slow. It's meant to be an anti-aggro card, but aggro decks have already killed you by turn 9. So it doesn't see play. Plus, you can't even heal it. Like, if this was a priest in a priest deck, if you could heal it, it'd be awesome. But you can't. Blood of the Ancient One. 9 mana, 9/9. If you control 2 of these at the end of your turn, merge them into the Ancient One. This is a meme. This card is a meme. It's too slow. It doesn't see competitive play. Nobody plays it, except in meme decks. I have seen this card played in a Barnes deck that tries to bring it out. So it has 2 Ancient Ones, Barnes and Bran, and you play Bran Barnes, and you summon 2 Ancient Ones and get a 30-30. So it's a meme deck. It was never meant to be competitive. It was just meant to be fun. Blade of C'Thun. All right, we're almost done, guys. 9 mana, 4/4, Battlecry, destroy a minion, and add its attack and health to your C'Thuns. So C'Thun Rogue was a thing for a little while, and Blade of C'Thun was why. Bran, Blade of C'Thun, gave your C'Thun like 20-20, and then you could smash people with it. Problem is just Rogue's problem. It has no effective healing, and Blade of C'Thun was too slow. Yasharaj, Rage Unbound. This card's story is so interesting to me. When it first came out, everybody's comparing it to the other old gods and was like, this sucks. It puts 1 minion? What's the point of that? That's such a terrible effect. It's too slow. Yeah, it's 10/10 and then you get another minion, but like, it's probably going to die and then it's not going to see its effect again. Right? Like, how often is it going to live? Well, it turns out that 10/10s live longer than people thought they do. And with the advent of Barnes, people were creating decks where they just had Barnes and Yasharaj. And that's it. And then so Yasharaj would summon Yasharaj. And so you would get 3-4, a 1-1, and a 10-10 on turn 4. And if people couldn't kill the 10-10, you win the game. So these very meme-y decks came out of it. And I'm just glad the card is seeing play because it's an old god. I have an affection for the old gods, and I want it to be an effective card. And so, oddly enough, C'Thun is not seeing play, but Yashiraj is. And N'Zoth has sort of started to fall by the wayside a little bit too. So, in a weird way, aside from Yogg-Saron, Yashiraj is the most played old god now. Who knew? When it first came out, everybody thought it was going to be the worst and would see no play. It's actually seeing more play now than C'Thun and N'Zoth. Weird. Yogg-Saron, Hope's End, 10 mana, 7-5, cast a random spell. You've cast this game. So everybody knew Yogg-Saron was going to be ridiculous. Everybody knew he was going to create memes. Not everybody knew it was going to be as effective as it is, and it's really the best comeback mechanic out of any card. And, you know, people just play and play and hold on to Yogg-Saron and just play spells and... You know, if they win the game, then great. If they start losing and they see no other way, they're just like, all right, play Yogg-Saron and hope for the best. And a lot of times it ends up refilling their hand and clearing the board. So, who knew, man? I don't like Yogg-Saron. I don't like having it in my decks. Except for Meme Hunter, which is an awesome deck and is a video you can see. But yeah, it's just kind of become the bane of the tournament scene now. And a lot of players are hoping they can ban it. And Firebat actually had a tournament called Batstone, and Yogg-Saron was banned from that, and I thought it actually made for a better tournament experience. N'Zoth the Corruptor, 10 mana, 5-7, Battlecry, summon your Death Rattle minions that died this game. Love this card. My favorite old god. So glad it's seeing play. I have tried to make more N'Zoth decks work than any other of the old gods. And it actually is effective. There's N'Zoth Paladin. There is N'Zoth Rogue. It sees play in Egg Paladin now. It sees play. There's a N'Zoth Warrior that is seeing a lot of play now. So its applications are pretty wide. And I think it's a very good card. And me personally, I think it's the best old god. But it is slow. And the problem is that when it resummons all these things, if your opponent has a board, they can still kill you. So that's the only issue with it. Faceless Behemoth, 10 mana, 10-10. Lame. Why not play Yashiraj if you're going to do that? It's just silly. This is an arena card. It's not bad in arena, actually. Deathwing Dragonlord, 10 mana, 12-12. Deathrattle, put all dragons from your hand into the battlefield. This card is so damn slow, it doesn't see play in dragon decks. Which is the deck that you'd want to put it in. And that blows my mind. I still have it in my Deathrattle Dragon Priest. But that deck has become less and less effective as time has gone on. I still think it's a good card. I still think there's a deck out there that can utilize it. And people love dragons. So I'm still hopeful, but too slow. C'Thun is C'Thun. C'Thun makes C'Thun decks. C'Thun decks are not that effective. But C'Thun is still awesome. Doom. 10 mana, destroy all minions, draw a card for each. Why is this a warlock card? Why? This should be a priest card. Right? Warlocks already draw cards. They don't need to draw more cards. What's the point of Doom? It's just silly. It's another Twisting Nether. They already have Twisting Nether. Dumb deck. So, that's it. That is my Whispers of the Old Gods card review with a Karazhan perspective. So hope you guys liked it. Hope you guys really enjoyed it. I definitely enjoyed making it. Thank you so much for sticking with me and watching the whole way. I really appreciate it. Please check out all my other videos. Please like, please subscribe. www.twitch.tv/bachatarockstar to see the live streams. Thank you so much, everyone. Really appreciate it. Have a good evening. Rockstar is out of here.